mix that up a bit, and you move your gator hand at random time, or and move your scratch hand in like a baby scratch fashion, you get what you call a march scratch, or a military scratch. It's like you're marching. All right, everybody getting up. Okay. If you notice, Q sometimes does a pause in between his movements on his scratch hand. That's what we call a tear scratch. All you're doing is pausing as many times as you want, back or forth. It sounds like you're ripping something up. Just the basic scratches, so if you're a DJ, these should be like your first and that most important scratches to practice. The next scratch is, let's try the chirp scratch, made famous by DJ Jazzy Jeff, who will be there at ScratchCon 2000, so if you guys can make it, he'll be there. Will Smith, Fresh Prince fame, of course. He used a whistle sound and made it sound like a bird flying or chirping. We're using the aw sound here. Call the chirp scratch. Yeah. Hard scratch to do if you're not warmed up. The next scratch, also made famous by DJ Spin Bad, Philadelphia, and popularized on Wax by Jazzy Jeff, and named by the one and only DJ Cash Money himself. It's called the Transformer Scratch. All you're doing is moving the record back and forth, turning on and off the fader, making like the Transformer robot sound. Save your question, please. Please save your question. Okay, there's this guy in Burlingame, California, probably the tallest DJ in the world, DJ Flair, right over here. He's never performed in his life. And he was trying to do the Transformer scratch, but instead of starting on the off position, he started on the on position and invented what he named after himself, the Flair scratch. He's going to demonstrate the one-click flare. It's actually more of a deceiving scratch where it sounds like you're getting two sounds with one click. That's a one-click flare. Of course, there's going to be the two-click flare, or the two-click orbit, two forward, two back. Put a combination of a one-click, two-click, to a three-click flare. Back to a one-click, two-click, then to a three-click flare. I know you're not warmed up, but let's see it anyway. You're a show-off, aren't you? All right. Then came this guy. I was working at the mall one day, called me up, and said, hey, I found this crazy new scratch. So I ran over to his house and showed me where you can utilize all your fingers like you would if you're a piano player. And he didn't know what to name it, and he called it the crab scratch. So all you're doing is turning on and off the sound, utilizing all your fingers. It's called the crab scratch. Of the basic scratches. So what do you got? Some rubs. Of course, there's the magnificent scribbles. You can also move the scribble. What else we got? How about some laser scratches? I'm just looking at what he's doing, so. How about some two-hand lasers? Of course, if you turn off the power, like I said, do the ever so famous tweak scratch. Those are some sound effects. Up some swipes too. Let's do some pitch changes if we're not. All you're doing is making the volume lower or higher. This is your cue to get off. The record's about to end anyway, so just watch him go freestyle, do a combination of everything. Set up for the next part, I think. All right, let's get back to the more fun filled scratching here. This is what we call drumming. Basically, you take all the parts of the drum, a normal drum that you have, and you guys play drums at home. I'm sure everyone here has a drum set, right? Good, good, good. I'm glad you guys know all about drums. Well, imagine you had a drum set. Put it onto, put the sound of the drum kicks, the snares, bass, whatever you have on your drums. Onto the vinyl. You can manipulate it and make your own drum patterns. Drumming. All right. More questions? Oh yes.
How did he develop that like crazy ass hand thing for his record?
Oh, you don't want to know. Qbert's let's just say Qbert's single. So. Yes, sir. What's that?
Joe Fooley.
Oh, Joe Fooley scratch. Where is Joe Fooley here today, Q? His hair is here. Any other questions? Yes. Hydroplane. That's like the scribble. Well, you want to show a hydroplane, sir? It's like a moving. It's like rubbing, or rubs. I should have said it was hydroplanes too. Yes, sir.
Broiled swine armpit.
Broiled swine armpit. How does that sound? That's a bee. Oh, it's a scratch. That's when Qbert runs around with his Speedos later on. Yes, sir.
The seesaw scratch.
Seesaw scratch. Yes, sir.
You scratch with a guitar and shit, like make sound like a guitar. Yeah, it's all way twisted.
Oh, I remember that. That's something.
Get a guitar sound.
Guitar sound? No, it's off the.
I could have an LA to check out how it sounds.
Is it a guitar sound or a guitar sound? Sounds like guitar.
Okay, we'll do like a version of the guitar thing on Q's one of his routines. Yes, sir. Tear flares. Ooh. There we go. All right. You guys want to know what records we're using, especially this one right here. It's called the new Sealed Breaks. It doesn't skip, it'll always land. Yeah, look, we're going to demonstrate it right now. So, like, all of a sudden, you guys ever watch like House Party or something, and someone bumps into your table and stuff and goes on? So if I just like, I don't know, I'm going to really extremely do this, but it'll always land on the same kick or snare of your, or whatever you scratch. People will trip out like, wow, you're doing that routine or something like that. But actually, it's like a safety record that'll always jump to the same snare or a different, you know. And then at the end, there's a
the skipless on, skipless seal breaks. I think it just came out this week, so yeah, that's why if you notice cues, well, especially this record doesn't skip. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Rock the bell.
Rock the bell.
Yeah.
Okay, we're gonna do that. It'll have the guitar, I guess, incorporated into it. This was a... We're gonna describe what juggling is right about now. Don't worry, he didn't juggle that. I'm just kidding. Alright, we'll let's see. Right under you. Okay, we got some CDs. A lot of questions. How's everyone doing? Who's going to ScratchCon? Anyone? Wow. That's pretty crazy. We have some ScratchCon posters here too. They're limited edition posters. We got all the participants from since May. We've added a lot more people like DJ Aladdin and some other. I can't say it yet. Okay, I can't say it yet. This surprise. Oh, God. Gave it away. Thank you. I just made your knee a jump. So. But yeah, that's a scratch con. We got some posters here. We got some Dirt Style posters, too. Oh, we got some scratch con t-shirts. I think we're going to sell, I guess. Mixers? Yes, the new ISP, our Invisible Scratch Pickle Vestax model, will come out at scratch con as well. So, can I say what's on there? Yeah, okay, I'll just say it, I don't care. The new mixer before, are you ready? Well, the new mixer actually, well, you know, we can talk about that later. Sorry, we'll talk about that later. All right, this is juggling. If you guys have never seen what juggling is, Q's gonna use a song, Pat Jam, and juggle that. You got two of the same records, or you can use two different records. Use the original sound, rhythm, beats, song on that record and make it your own way. And hopefully it won't skip. So, it's called beat juggling. Now, if you're at a rave, this is the kind of drumming you hear. Well, not one hand drumming. This is called drumming. Okay, there you go. I guess we're going to do a little question and answer stuff session before, yeah, we go.
Yes.
Take a little break here.
How you guys doing? Oh, good. So, all right, good. I can tell by your overwhelming response. I want you all to remember what you saw, because in like 100 years, they're going to say that it was aliens that brought this technology, and it wasn't like one person and the history of DJs that came before him. My name is David Goldberg, and I'm sort of a scholar of DJ culture. I've been keeping track of it since they were playing my high school dances back in like... back then, right? Yeah, then. She's in the chair. A few things to like sort of pay attention to. I mean, now that we're sort of out of the nerd, the geek phase, like if you've heard Kid Koala's new record, he has an amazing scratch on there where he says that, you know, the turntablists are really the nerds that we think they are. We're gonna talk a little bit about the culture of where this stuff comes from. And personally, I wanna thank sort of the Scratch Pickles and a lot of the Bay Area DJs, because when hip hop was going through a very dark phase, they were keeping it alive. So, you know, thanks for that. And you can hear that in the sort of the opening breaks that Qbert was scratching over. A lot of it up-tempo stuff is what I grew up on and they grew up on. So what I wanted to first ask is what you do in music? Is it music?
Is it music?
Obviously, yes.
All right, good. Because a lot of people, you know, want to say that turntabling or DJing or scratching and stuff like that is not music, and it's just, I don't know. A lot of people still think you move the needle across the record to make that sound instead of forward and back. Would you classify it as hip hop? Do you feel you're firmly in that tradition?
Its roots come from hip hop, you know, because the drums we use, we love to use like hip hop drums. But you can call it whatever you want. You can call any music whatever you want, you know.
Right. So how long you been doing it?
16 years.
16 years.
Ever since I was 17.
And how did you start? There's all kinds of legends about, you know, how you got your skills, ranging from aliens to a broken leg, and you were trapped in a basement for like years, and you know how you got your skills together. I mean, what made you start turntabling?
I just love music my whole life, and I just like, how many of you guys DJ? It's basically, you guys just love it, right? It's just fun, you know, like seeing sound, you know, being like grabbed with your hands, and it's like, you know, it's cool.
Right. You did the whole Wave Swisters record. It's nothing but like vinyl manipulations, right? Like what you guys saw was just one guy, but correct me if I'm wrong, but it's like actually all of you guys on some of the tracks working like a band, right?
Yeah, most of it is turntable. Some of it's some sample drums. And Buckethead, who plays guitar, he does bass on the record for one song.
How many people have heard the record yet out there? That's all of you. It's kind of important, right? And it's real different from, you know, there's a huge scene now in terms of DJ culture. I mean, there's a lot of magazines that are putting it on their front page, you know. A lot of DJs are getting sort of front page coverage of what they do. What do you guys think about, like, the DJ as a cultural figure now?
It's funny because since we went to Japan, or since the first time we've been touring, and coming back from Japan, they would always tell us about how, well, even since the first time, how the turntable would outsell the guitar every year, even more. You can go, now it's in Europe. The turntable outsells the guitar, and the turntable outsells the guitar in Japan as well. Last year alone, they sold, like, in this six-figure numbers, like, over 100,000 plus scratch DJ mixers in the world. So I guess you could see by where manufacturers are focusing more on, you know, to the scratch DJ market, you see where the whole market's evolving. But I guess it's still in the underground, which is good, because its roots are, I mean, just scratching roots are staying pretty much well versed in the DJ community and well-knowledge. So when it does spread out to a larger audience, people will understand it more fully. And that's why, you know, we thank you guys for having us here to actually explain it more fully. And of course, we're going to go on and do some more stuff. But okay, shut up.
I mean, I'm glad you brought that point up. Do you guys think that the turntabling can be sort of co-opted in the way that some parts of rap did? You think that, like, all right, you know, will you guys ever sell out? Are we going to hear, like, you scratching on a Lexus commercial?
You know, that's possible. Anything's possible.
Right.
But for us, we like to stay true to the music and stuff. We wouldn't make something, like, say we compromised musical integrity for simpler minds, like, say, some simple dance music and the scratches were simple or something. I mean, if it was some simple dance music with some complex scratching, that's cool, but nothing where it'd be like, hey, we're dancing, nothing like that.
I think if the scratching always stays well ahead of even, you know, to the peers or the really elite scratchers out there, I would still respect it. I mean, if I saw, like, say, a Lexus commercial and there was this really, really dope DJ just getting off on the turntables, but it was a cheesy commercial, I would still respect them because I would be like, wow, you know, out of nowhere you get this guy, you know, better than anyone. I guess that's my point of view, as long as the scratching is dope. But I don't know, what do you...
I mean, so what does that mean to you guys, like musical integrity? I mean, what does that mean? Like, you just won't scratch certain sounds, or...
I think if there's no skill involved or any creativity or anything, and they're just doing to follow the trend because it sells, because that certain style will sell, then that's kind of faulty. But if you're doing something different from everyone else and offering people a new style of music, then I think that's more important.
So I'm going to pause here. Do you guys have any questions, like, along those lines? Yeah. Like Limp Bizkit and what you call rapcore? I like that rapcore. Did that affect, you know, turntabling to you guys by them incorporating DJs into it?
I mean, I think that's cool if they would do something, but a lot of times you see the video and they're not really doing anything. Have you heard that whole album of Limp Bizkit?
Yeah.
Does DJ go off anywhere?
Yeah, there's parts, like, after a song, they'll just let him go offline.
Well, that's kind of cool. As long as he's doing that, that's cool. But if he's out there as a prop, you know, hey, we got a DJ, and he just... That doesn't make any sense, of course.
Yeah, there's a lot of bands, like, there's a lot of trade shows we perform at as well, doing the same thing, and you see a lot of bands, like, say, Fred and the rest of the crew from Limp Bizkit would just come in and actually, you know, research and try to understand it and how to incorporate it into their music a lot more. I mean, I think it's been around since Grandmix or DXT formed in the first band, you know, with Herbie Hancock. It died out for a while, but I guess when Mixmaster Mike jumped on with the Beastie Boys and everyone saw the potential of having your band just being the DJ, I guess it sparked up a whole bunch of others to come out. And I guess as long as, you know, the DJ knows, I don't know, I think we should all be happy. No, I think it's great. I think, personally, for myself, as long as the scratching is still upholding its properties. You know, Peter Parker, good friend of ours, you know, you guys ever seen the Big Mac commercial? And then starts, you know, doing his body trick thing, and then all of a sudden, you know, Big Mac comes out and starts biting, and he walks away. I mean, I don't know. He's going to kill me now.
Yeah. Yeah, so he'd like you guys to talk about the impact that Jazzy Jeff made on sort of DJing in general and you guys in specific.
Yeah, when Jazzy Jeff came out, at the time, all the DJs that I knew, they were like, oh man, that's all the scratches that can be done, you know. And then we heard Jazzy Jeff do the chirps and the transforms and all the styles that he was doing. It was like, you know, damn, where were we, you know? And so he totally brought a whole new vocabulary to the words of DJing.
Does everybody know who Jazzy Jeff is? Yes? I mean, one, two, three, well, in brief, he's a Philly DJ from, like, Philadelphia was, like, a hotbed for DJs, and still is, and was really influential on the battle circuits and stuff like that. You heard him mention Cash Money and some other people like that. A question over there?
How much time did you spend on production on Wave Twisters?
So the question is how much time he spent producing Wave Twisters?
I did like 10 months. Like, you know, some people will go in the studio and they go, oh man, we got studio day, we gotta get the deadline, blah, blah, blah. I just said, you know, I'm gonna make this, I'm gonna make sure it's good. And I took my time and about 10 months and It still didn't sound good.
I mean, do you guys hear any value in, like, stuff that's produced with computers now? I mean, when you listen to what you guys are doing, I mean, you can do basically any break. And if there's three of you, then, you know, you don't need a sequencer or any of that stuff. Like, what do you guys think about the hip-hop that's still being produced with samplers and loops?
The hip-hop that's produced with samplers, and that's an art in itself. The only thing I see wrong with that is sometimes you can let yourself go too far and let the computers control you. And what we like to listen to more is jazz music because it's like live instruments. And so when we work, we like to do everything live. It's electronic music, but it's live. It's not, we're not just pressing a button and letting it just go. We're actually playing.
So what jazz do you guys listen to?
Oh, tons of stuff. Dave Brubeck, Miles Davis.
Al Di Meola. If you guys pick him up, that's my... Q introduced me to him. It's like favorite guitarist.
Next question.
What was the name of the guitar?
Oh, Al Di Meola. Get the it's called Mediterranean Sundance. You guys want to pick up the baddest trio ever to perform? Oh man, I drank the water. Baddest trio on guitars.
Yeah.
I think that's cool. Everyone's gonna have their own style, just like with a guitar. Someone's gonna play classical, someone's gonna play jazz, someone's gonna play rock guitar, someone's gonna play punk rock. You know, everyone has their own style, so there's no good or bad in anything.
Next question? Yeah.
Are you guys bothered by the turntablist?
So the question is, are they bothered by the label turntablist? Do you guys know where that came from? Did you guys?
DJ Bamboo made it. I guess for the new generation, it's kind of the word turntablism or turntablist, but I guess we come from old school, so it's like, it's kind of like, you know how B-boys, they don't like the term breakdancing or being called breakdancing. They don't like that. They'd rather be called a breaker or a B-boy. And for us, we'd rather be called like scratch DJs or scratchers or just playing DJs because, yeah, it just feels weird, but we can't escape, so, you know, everywhere we go, I guess it's, you know, turntablism, it's whatever, it's cool.
So I'm gonna ask, like, the big question. Now, in the beginning of one of the turntable TV commercials, videos, you guys are in Ceremony with the date book, and you're talking to people saying, like, you know who we are, and, like, nobody knows. Who you are, and is it what's up with that? Like, what do you think? Like, you guys are famous in these circles, but at the same time, you can go like right back in your community and like,
thanks.
People are like, what?
I don't know. It's always like that. I guess it's cool. You know, I mean, we were just doing that actually for the funny sense of it. I guess we were. I don't know. Yeah,
not
it was just
bitter. I didn't want
no, we weren't bitter at all. It's like we kind of liked having this more of a like to be a cult following. You know, the true heads always, you know, stay, you know, with us everywhere we go, no matter what character we are on Turntable TV or if we goof off and do something, they can relate to us. It's like we make the video, we make all the things we do independently, never to appease to like someone higher than us. We want to always make our own music. We want to, you know, do things the way we want to, because all our friends, like all of you guys, DJ or not DJ, Filipino, whatever you are, it relates to us. So I guess that's why we always wanted to, I guess it was just a for fun thing, because, you know, Huey did a Ceremony a lot at one time, and I think he liked that a little bit. And he's still saying that.
Sorry.
Do they have non-musical influences?
Yeah, like speakers, the way they speak, and the way they pause and stuff, and nature too. Go listen to like birds. But like Ocean, the rhythm of it kind of like inspires you sort of.
I told you, it's been a long time for this guy.
Anything else? Next question. Right here.
Oh, all right, back in like the 80s, right? A lot of the DJs, they were mainly like battling, like, scratching the track. And then now that battle DJs and scratchers, whatever, they're getting really big and they got the whole music. You battle before, now you don't battle. You see a lot of DJs like Babu, Big Ron, Shortcut, they don't battle anymore. What do you guys think about, you know, the level of skill keeps on rising, keeps on rising. Everybody wants to make their music. What do you think of the future of battle in, say, like 20 years? You think DJs, they're going to be so good, they don't even want to battle anymore, so they're not going to be any more battling? Or, I mean, what do you guys feel about that? It seems like a lot of battles today. They don't want to battle.
So in brief, what's the future of battle DJs?
I think, as far as us, like, we used to compete a lot, and we love competing and making something new. So when we stopped competing, the whole energy is still there because we're still trying to do something new every day. Like, outdo, instead of competing against other people, we try to outdo what we did yesterday. Like, try to be less wacker from yesterday. And, you know, I think at the time, maybe there was, a lot of it has to do with, there was no internet. So the only way to get your name out there was to compete in a battle. And for you to get notoriety, that was the way to be seen on videos. Now with like the internet, people can just bust on the internet. Like the videos, we make Turntable TV, we like to showcase like new talent, and people can get out without competing. We're making mixtapes, and they cut on mixtapes, you know, different ways of outlet now.
Yeah, before, back in the day, there were, when jazz was first, you know, forming in its new shapes and sounds, they had what, well, we call it battling now, but jazz, you know, people playing the trumpets or saxophones would have cutting contests, and they would, like, maybe once a week or once a month go to a jazz club and compete against each other who could play the best, you know. And I think in time, you know, people will find the more musical sense of scratching and not more of the, you know, taking out the next guy. And but taking them out, say, in your music, you know, making the best music. And I guess jazz, you know, further evolved, not having that cutting contest so popular anymore, and they made more music.
What do you think about, like, DJs who would rather mix as opposed to, like, scratching? Like, mixing is, like, pretty much, like, the essence of DJing, where scratching comes from. But, like, what do you think about DJs who just rather... like, they can scratch it, but they just rather, like, mix and stuff, like Shortcut.
Yeah, that's cool, like I said earlier. Or did you want
to... I mean, the question is what they think about DJs prefer to just mix rather than scratch.
Like I said earlier, there's no good or bad. It's if you want to wear bell bottoms, go wear bell bottoms. If you want to wear Speedos, go ahead and do what you want. It's all good.
We have a question in the back. They have a large following of youth, and they feel a responsibility to educate them, which kind of dovetails. I was going to ask you guys, do you guys feel political in any way?
Well, I guess, you know, we like to hang out with, you know, everyone thinks we're, I don't know, I guess we have a following. We do in some sort, but, you know, we like to just, you know, chill out with everyone. You know, if we could stay here all day, we would with you guys and just hang out and scratch, and we could hear you guys. For us, it's more of like a musical journey, you know? We like to learn out of everyone. You know, we stopped, I guess, competing too, because we want the music to explode and actually bring out more styles, more techniques, more sounds, and, you know, everyone has something to offer. So for us, we're always just trying to learn every day, like you always talks about learning every day. You know, for us, I guess we do what we do, I guess, because we love it, but, you know, for everywhere we go, we would always try to, like, say, find, you know, some friends or people who are in scratching and just try to learn from them, too. So I guess, I don't know if I answered your question correctly, but that's the way we look at it. It's not really a following we try to, like, say we're trying to educate. We actually are looking to learn more from everyone, too, as well.
Next question. Well, I got one more for you. guys got the website, right? You guys put out your own break records, you put out your own videos, you're getting into designing gear and electronics, right? So it's kind of a, you're on all fronts in the art forms. Like, where do you guys see that going in the next 10 years? With, like, the net and technology getting better and stuff like that?
Wow. Every year it changes so much drastically for us. This year, you know, of course, a lot of things have happened in this area because of the internet, and we focus so much on that with the sites we partnered with. But it's hard to say, you know, we try to get involved with every aspect of the art, from designing and manufacturing all, and even promoting and marketing all the, you know, all the equipment that that's made, from tours to new music. I guess what we're trying to do now, the biggest thing is, of course, Q's movie, and four albums from the group, from D-Styles albums coming out. And I guess our biggest project is the ScratchCon 2000, where we want to further educate everyone about scratch music and, you know, and further in depth, like, get into it. Not with just us anymore, but masters of, you know, of the art besides us, you know, of course, like the Executioners in New York, the Allies and the East Coast, and the Beach Empties in LA will all be there in one forum for everyone to learn more about this musical art. And then I guess we're going to expand from what we do with the ScratchCon again.
And so who's writing the history of all this? Who's writing it down?
I guess we're trying to as well at the same time. We've done a lot of documentaries with, you know, people who, you know, was interested in filming the evolution.
Battle Sounds.
Yeah, Battle Sounds. Hang the DJ. There's like four new films coming out on what we're doing about scratching. So I guess, you know, one day, I don't know, it's going to come out. The closest person I know is probably Billy Jam, who's pretty much, you know, in touch with us, like, on a periodical basis, trying to jot down what's new and what's going on. But I don't know what the future really holds. I guess we're just trying to promote the art form as much as we can, and to its purest form, I guess.
Question?
Favorite Bob James record?
I just know a few breaks.
So it's not just looking at the right snare. You listen to more than 3 seconds of the given.
Yeah, like
you
said earlier, you listen to a lot of jazz.
Yeah.
How long does it take you guys to make a break record?
How long does it take to make a break record?
I think Scratchy Seal just finished this new record called Seal Breaks 2. I think it took them like a few weeks. You just have to really just get down and do your research and get your hands dirty trying to make some new work. So that's one of my last talks with everybody.
Have you guys ever gotten sued over a break record?
Break record? No, we actually promote it for good style. We don't actually make it.
Yeah, Dust Tater makes them. The last part.
Seriously, good. Any other questions? Right here?
I've always been curious about the name, Invisible Scratch Pickles. Like, I understand the scratch part, but the invisible and the pickle
part.
Any particular reason? Or just like random?
Different answer every time.
It's just like, you know, smashing pumpkins or Red Hot Chili Peppers. You know, we have our own record label. It's called Galactic Butt Hair. We pick out two words. I pick out two. You pick one. Put it together. That's what we usually do. Like for our, you know, videos. The newest one's Wash Your Trash. I don't know.
Question.
If
you had to rate yourself, where you think you are in
like,
the scale.
So if they had to rate themselves based on where they are, where they want to be, Qbert specifically, where he wants to be versus where he's at on a scale of 1 to 10, where are you?
I'd say like a six and a half.
Question in the back?